You're about to see the programming enable sequence used to sign on to an AVR microcontroller's ISP programming interface in detail, something that's normally done by a device programmer rather than a slightly crazy human programmer with little more than switches and lights. You'll see some of how the ISP protocol works and what I have on this board. In future videos, I'll read out the chip's signature, operate its flash, and maybe program some code to blink this LED that's on here, using only what you see on this board. Here's a mostly complete list of AVR parts, and here are those that support the ISP protocol that you're about to see. ISP stands for In-Circuit Serial Programming. The bulk of these chips that support ISP also support a high voltage mode, which is not really intended for programming the chip in its application circuit. ISP is also sometimes called low-voltage serial programming to contrast it with the high-voltage serial method. It's also sometimes called serial to contrast it with the high-voltage parallel method. But neither of these serials are the typical logic-level UART-type serial. As usual, terminology is messy. In fact, it uses a form of serial peripheral interface, or SPI. If you don't know what SPI is, you don't need to worry about it for this video. SPI isn't a specific protocol, it's really more of a generic set of patterns found in serial protocols. ISP fits one of those patterns. On the chips that have it, ISP mode is enabled per factory default settings, but you can disable ISP, and that can be done through ISP by accident. If you do that, you need a programmer that supports one of the high voltage modes in order to recover from that situation. The chip also has to be in a circuit that will accept being programmed in that way. And many circuit boards just aren't designed for that. You can also reconfigure the chip in a number of ways to make it incompatible with the circuit that it's in, even though you haven't actually disabled the ISP interface. So, if you're experimenting, it may be better to use a DIP package AVR that you're not worried about or will be easier to recover should you happen to have a high voltage mode programmer. The one I'm demonstrating with is the ATtiny 13A, but here's the same board connected to a comparatively massive ATmega 2560 chip. All I've done is replace the ATtiny 13A with jumpers leading over to the other board's programming header. I actually did this to verify something for this video. For anyone that's used an ATtiny 85 before, the ATtiny 13A is very similar, it's just very stripped down. In fact, it uses the same exact pinout with respect to programming it via ISP. Here's a model of what I have on the board. I wouldn't get too hung up on the specifics of how I've done it. Some of the decisions were based around what would show up on camera and what would be comfortable and what I happen to have. This is not the only way I've done it, and you have a lot of options. In order to program the chip, unsurprisingly, you're going to need power. Up here I have a USB micro B breakout that's being used to take roughly 5 volt and ground to supply the board. I have about 4.7 microfarads of bulk capacitance, which probably isn't needed, but it's not bad to have. That 5 volt and ground comes down to the ATtiny 13A chip, and across the top of it I've put a 0.1 microfarad decoupling capacitor. At one point I had a short enough USB cable that I was able to get away without this, but it's good to have, and I needed it for the longer cable anyway. In the upper left is a switch for controlling reset. ISP programming happens in the reset state. It's common for AVR circuits to have a resistor from the active low reset to the supply to keep the chip out of reset until the signal is grounded or made active low. However, the reset pin has an internal pull-up, which I usually find is sufficient for this sort of setup. During programming, you don't need to change the reset signal that often, so a jumper would work fine for connecting it to ground rather than a switch. I happen to be using a double throw switch, and because there was no reason not to, I wired the up position to solidly connect reset to the supply. Switch bounce, or jumper bounce I suppose, isn't really a problem here. For what we're doing, it's okay if the chip goes in and out of reset a couple of times before settling on whichever state we need. On the lower left, there's a switch to control the value of the next bit going into the chip. Most AVR datasheets refer to this signal as the master out slave in, or MOSI signal. Some AVR datasheets call it the programming data in signal. There are a lot of alternative SPI names. Main and sub are sometimes used as replacements for master and slave that don't change the abbreviations. I've used a double throw switch. It connects MOSI directly to the supply for a 1 and to ground for a 0. There's also an indicator LED in parallel with it. For experimentation, bounce is not really a problem here either. It's sufficient that the signal settles before the clock switch is used. I'm just not going to be operating the switches fast enough for that to be a problem. You don't need to use a toggle switch. You could use a push button. You could also use a jumper, but that will be more painful. Here on the lower right, we have the clock switch. This controls the serial clock, or SCK signal, into the chip. This tells the AVR when to accept input from the data switch, or MOSI signal, and when to send data back on the MISO signal that will appear on this red LED. The clock signal is one where you do need to worry about signal bounce. I've gotten lucky using tack switches before with no actual debounce circuit at all. There apparently had been enough inherent resistance and capacitance in the circuit that I was able to sign on, but that's unusual. And big toggle switches tend to bounce like crazy. What I've done for debouncing is crude, but it's working just fine for me. The AVR has something called Schmitt trigger inputs that tolerate slow input edges, so I've just used an RC low-pass filter. There's also an LED indicator on this switch. This is a two-pole switch, so like two switches with their handles fused together. I've wired the indicator through the second pole, that way I didn't even need to think about how it would interact with the low-pass filter and what that would mean for debouncing. The AVR will let us operate the serial clock as slow as we like, which is a large part of what allows us to do this by hand. With this chip running at 1.2 MHz, and a quarter of that being 300 kHz, you could program with a serial signal operating up to 300 kHz. The speed at which I could operate this thing is largely limited by me as a human and the switch bounce that's involved in the data switch, and the RC filtering I've put on the clock switch. The AVR MISO, or programming data out signal, is connected to this red LED when this switch is in the down position, which it will be most of the time. In the up position, it routes the signal to this voltmeter instead. There's a pair of 4.7 k ohm resistors here that bias the meter to about mid-supply when the signal isn't being driven by the chip. You'll see why I'm doing that later. There are a lot of ways you could do this. I've used just jumpers, tack switches, I've used a meter instead of an LED for the output, I've used a 555 timer to create a clock from separate push buttons and from one double throw switch, I've used a microcontroller commanded over serial, and I've used a microcontroller board to do nothing but debounce switches. The exact way you make the signals with your hands is mostly unimportant apart from having a clean ISP clock signal. One thing you may want to consider though is that when the AVR is not in reset, it can run code, and that code can configure the SCK and MOSI pins as output. If I were worried about that, I'd have put some series resistance on my MOSI switch to limit the current in case the AVR drives it opposite of the direction I've put the switch in. I'm just not that worried about it. AVR datasheets have a whole section on ISP, in which you'll find a table of ISP instructions. This one is modeled after the one from the ATtiny 13A datasheet. All ISP instructions are 4 bytes or 32 bits long. The ISP instruction set has subtle variations that you'll see in these tables from one AVR datasheet to another. Some of them mark bit fields with X's like these to indicate don't care bits. That is, during communication, the values of these bits aren't significant. But some of the datasheets don't make this explicit and simply put zeros here where the don't cares are. Some of the instructions that operate on flash may be represented as having two commands, one for manipulating a high byte and one for a low byte, and some will combine them into a single table entry. Some bits and instructions are for addressing, Because some AVR have more memory than others, some of these fields will be documented as being wider or narrower depending on the chip. Some chips don't use a temporary page buffer when writing to flash, and some of these commands will be gone, and other ones that normally write to the flash temporary buffer write directly into flash instead. Some chips like the ATmega2560 you saw earlier on that larger board have so much flash that there aren't enough address bits in the regular flash instructions to address all of it, so they have extra instructions for setting extended address bits. Many AVR have a third configuration fuse that the ATtiny13A doesn't, so there'll be an extra instruction for reading and writing that fuse as well. So there are subtle differences in ISP documentation between datasheets, so it's a good idea to make sure you're looking at the instruction table for your particular part. Completely avoiding the instructions for writing fuses should help keep you from disabling ISP by accident, and then ending up needing a high voltage programmer in order to recover from that. So here we are with the ATtiny13A currently not in reset. It's in its factory configuration, that is, it's blank. It's running it from its internal oscillator at 1.2 MHz. It's currently trying to execute invalid instructions out of flash, which don't do anything. If there had been code on here to blink this LED, we'd be seeing that right now. To start programming, we need to make sure that the clock signal is low and enter reset by bringing the reset line low. If we had code on here to blink this LED, it would have stopped doing that the moment the reset switch was brought low. In the reset state, the chip is doing its best job to pretend that it doesn't exist in the circuit. But there is little ISP programming machinery in here that's listening for the program enable command, and that looks like this. On entering reset, if the chip sees any deviation from this programming enable command, it will ignore everything you do until you leave reset and re-enter reset. That includes seeing this clock signal low within a cycle or two of entering reset. As a human being with this thing running at 1.2 MHz, it's basically impossible to bring this low and then this below after it within two clock cycles. So we either have to have both of these low when we power up the board, or we have to bring SCK low before we bring reset low. I'm doing this with power already supplied to the chip, and I happen to know that there's no code on here that's going to drive the SCK pin as an output and high. So it's enough for me to lower SCK first and then lower reset. Some AVR datasheets will have a generic ISP diagram like this. Normally a programming device would sample the inbound data while raising the clock signal, and it would change the outbound data while lowering the clock signal as shown in the diagram. I would have to be flipping these switches pretty quickly in order for the switch bounce on this to be a problem when I raise the clock signal with this switch. So the basic process is we're going to look at the LED to see what data is inbound, assuming it's relevant. We'll set our data switch to the level we need for the data going into the chip, and then we'll raise and then lower the clock. And that happens for each bit in the transaction. Under normal circumstances, during programming, the AVR would be sending a signal out its MISO pin through this switch into the LED. Right now you can see that the red LED is not lit, and a question you might ask about that is it not lit because the chip is outputting a low or a zero, or is it not lit because the chip isn't outputting at all? To know the difference, you need something more like a logic probe that's designed to show you the difference. But for this, you don't need a logic probe. There are some things you could do with multiple LEDs. What I've done is a little different. With this switch in the up position, it's routing the MISO signal through the switch over to this meter. And connected to this meter are two 4.7K resistors. The resistors form a 1/2 voltage divider between the supply and ground. Until the chip wakes up and starts driving its programming output pin, the meter will just read mid-level or around 2.5 volts like it is now. If the chip does drive the MISO line, it will overpower the divider and you'll see a voltage on here that's much higher or much lower than about mid-rail. The chip has no idea what's connected to it in the circuit, and until you convince it that you're really trying to enter programming, it just stays hands-off, and that's the state we're in now. So I'm going to enter the first 15 bits of the programming enable instruction. So I need to send a 1 bit, so that I put the data switch high and raise and lower the clock. I need to send a 0, so data switch low, raise and lower the clock. And the process repeats like that for all the bits. Now I've just finished the 15th bit. On the next bit, watch what happens as I raise the clock signal on the meter. You can see it's dropped to a low value. So we can see now that the chip has actually woken up enough that it's driving its MISO output. I'm going to switch this back to the LED now. And now that I have, this is displaying mid-rail because it's no longer connected. So I'm just going to cover that up so it's not a distraction. Let me bring back down the clock signal to complete that 16th bit. The remaining 16 bits of the programming enable instruction are don't care bits, although they may be documented as zeros in some of the data sheets. For don't care bits, it doesn't matter what we send to the chip. It literally doesn't care. Conventionally, zeros are sent, but I'm going to send 8 ones followed by 8 zeros. Anytime the AVR isn't sending you data that you asked for, like it would when you were reading a flash byte, what it does is echo back the last byte that you sent it. It's kind of like a feedback mechanism that lets the programmer know that something is there. If MISO were connected to ground or the supply, we wouldn't get back both ones and zeros. If MISO weren't connected, it's unlikely that we'd see noise that looked exactly like the last 8 bits that we sent. As I send out the first 8 don't care bits, you'll see this LED turning on and off in accordance with the last byte that we sent. We're seeing a 1 now, because that's the first of the last 8 bits we sent. Now I'm going to send out 8 zeros. And you can see that the LED has gone out, showing us the first of the 8 zeros that we just sent coming back to us. So we are finally in programming mode. Unlike most spy devices, there's not a select signal that frames each command. They're all 32 bits long. If you screw anything up, you have to exit reset and re-enter it. And then you have to re-enter the programming instruction, which is why I've gotten fairly quick at that one. Now that you've seen all that, in the next video, I'll just blaze through the program enable command and show you that we really are communicating with the chip. I'll read out the chip signature and hopefully more. If you've made it this far and got something out of it, let me know.